Can I welcome everybody? My name is Burrell. I'm a member of Black Lives Matter movement and the North West London Stand Up to Racism. I'm a teacher in Newham. Our meeting today is from 10:45 to 12 p.m. We have three, possibly four speakers today. One who will be coming to us from via Skype. Hopefully the technology will be working. So we're going to keep the contributions of all the speakers quite short and then open up the meeting to everybody for contributions. So I'd like to welcome everybody to Confronting the Rising Racism, Stamp Out Islamophobia and Anti-Semitism National Conference. We are a broad campaign that welcomes refugees and stands up to all forms of racism. We believe in the unity of Muslim, Jewish, Christian people, and people of all faiths and none. Together with trade unionists, parliamentarians and students, LGBT communities and all anti-racists. Now more than ever, we need unity, especially given the announcements this week by the Tory government, which will clamp down on migrant rights and unleash reaction in the name of a hard Brexit. Police brutality and institutional racism is oppressing black communities in the US and here. Movements are rising to challenge this. And so our workshop today will look at how we can support families who are striving for justice. So our first speaker today is Kadisha Burrell, who is campaigning for justice for her brother, Kingsley Burrell, who died after being arrested in West Midlands by police officers in 2011. So welcome, Kadisha.
Good morning, thank you everybody for actually attending today's meeting. It's a poignant time right now, especially with the economic downturn and what's actually going on with Black Lives Matter movement in the US. With Kingsley's story, it began in March 2011. I am Kingsley Burrell's sister from Birmingham in the UK. Basically, my brother Kingsley Burrell called the police for help in March 2011 while he was actually being threatened with two guys. So after he called the police for help, the police actually arrived. This is what I've witnessed with my own two eyes. Looked on the CCTV footage. So basically, they seen that two guys came into the shop. Obviously, they didn't do anything to Kingsley, came back out the shop. My brother's demeanor and what was actually happening, he was sectioned under 136. 136 gave the police the power to section anyone who's actually delusional and who's actually a threat to themselves in a public place or a threat to somebody else in a public place. However, Kingsley wasn't a threat to anybody. He was vulnerable. He was calling for help. However, when the police arrived, they said he was delusional, he was seeing things, and he needed to be sectioned in 136 by help. Within a matter of 3 days, 72 hours, my brother was dead. Basically, he was restrained. The inquest verdict stated that it was a damning narrative verdict in April last year. So April 2015 is when we actually had the inquest. It took 5 years to where we are today to actually get any form of justice. The families that continue to fight continuously for over, 20, 50, 10 years. And this is just the beginning of our struggle. It took 18 months for the state to release his body to our family. 18 months of heartache and pain. However, when we told the system that we don't want them to touch any of his body parts, when Kingsley's body was released back to the family, his brain was missing, his heart was missing. These are things that families are actually going through on a day-to-day basis. So when we call out, say, Black Lives Matter, all lives do matter, yes. But when you are confronted with racism, institutional racism, because in terms of Kingsley's state, Kingsley's demeanor, he knew what was going on. He wrote down everything, even up until the point he was going to die. He wrote down, they are going to kill me. Day, time, all of this evidence I have gathered along the way. Hence the CPS stating ahead of the inquest in April 2015 that there's insufficient evidence. At this moment in time, we are still waiting for the CPS to actually decide whether or not there's going to be any criminal prosecution in relation to my brother's death. But with God's strength and with God's will and with the solidarity and the system behind us and all family, United Family Friends and Campaign, we are striving for change. This time last year was in America, touring America with Mark Duggan's brother, Sean Riggs' sister, Marcia Riggs, and Stephanie Lightfoot Bennett. There was four of us that went to America on behalf of Black Lives Matter UK. And when we arrived in the US, they could not believe the extent that is actually happening over here, because it's all covert. It's all shoved under the carpet. A lot of people don't actually know what's happening. We know about Mike Brown. We know about Sarah Bland. They didn't know about Kingsley Burrell. They knew about Mark Duggan because that's the one that caused the riot. His death caused the riots. However, if we don't fight against our unity, we would never have a voice in this country where we're living today. And I thank everyone for actually coming today to actually hear what's actually happening with my brother's case. So basically just whatever we're doing, whatever families and family friends and campaigners are doing, be behind them. Because at the end of the day, it can happen to anybody. And my brother was vulnerable. He didn't deserve to die. Hence the reason why I'm here still continuing to fight 5 years on. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Capres Turner, who organised the Black Lives Matter demonstration in the summer outside the US Embassy in London. Capres.
Hi everybody, so I'm Capres Willow Turner, I'm 19 years old and I am an anthropology. Nice to bring a bit of lightheartedness. I'm an anthropology and sociology student at Goldsmiths University. I've just started this term actually. In July I organised the Black Lives Matter protest, July the 10th it was, in Oxford Street. We went to the US Embassy. We went down through Victoria, we went to Parliament Square, and it was a really amazing day. Over 3,000 people turned up, and I mean, when I was organising this, naive it sounds, I kind of just made a Facebook event, didn't really think like people would come, maybe like a couple of my friends, maybe about 30 of us, and it turned out that the message just spread like wildfire, and like I kind of really realised the power that one person has to not necessarily always make a difference, but influence others as well, the influence you have on other people, because I don't necessarily feel that my protest itself has obviously made this incredible change in our community, like, because it hasn't yet, but it's what comes from it, and there's been different spirals that came off of it, haven't there? I mean, we've seen like the protests at the city airports, the UK shutdown. I actually didn't know that some of this was happening, and like, I'd like read, like my cousin would send me a text, like, hey, look at this, I'd be like, oh my goodness, like this is all came from like one person just making one smart decision, I suppose. That's the best way I could put it. So the media, should we talk about the media quickly? They are interesting bunch, aren't they? It's how we use media. The social media at the moment is so prevalent in our lives because we are stepping into a digital age. So, you know, My advice is to just think about what you're posting on social media. I put in my bio on Twitter that I was a model because I do some commercial modelling. I've done like two or three things. And then that's what the Daily Mail just grabbed. And they're like, model! Like, you know, they didn't say I was a student. They didn't say I was like worked in Sainsbury's. They said I was a model. And, you know, then I started getting hate abuse from people that are obviously against the movement and saying, oh, you know, look at her, blah, 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 this and that. And then obviously with the London City Airports recently, I've done a charity skydive, and they're like, oh, look at what she's done, she's a hypocrite, you know, she's done a skydive, she's using air travel. And it's like, what's going on here? Like, what? It's for charity, guys. So, my point is just be careful what you put on social media, and obviously don't believe everything the media says, because, you know, this Daily Mail we're talking about. But also they can be on our side. I mean, I'm working with the BBC at the moment. I've spoke to a lot of people that are very, very interested in how all of a sudden this has become a huge thing. It's like all of a sudden it's everywhere. There's movies coming out about race. There's a new movie coming out called The United Kingdom. And it talks of, it's basically about what happened to the apartheid in South Africa and how it relates to Botswana and how they became, they nominated her for, sorry, I'm going off on a tangent. yeah, so that's the media. And I want to talk about being black quickly as well. So where the origins come from, because being black stems mainly from Africa, and we generally tend to think of Africa as pre-colonial, colonial, then post-colonial. And there's like a huge issue there. Instantly we're giving privilege to the colonialists, aren't we? Because, you know, there's so much more to Africa. It's this wonderful spiritual place. And we're so I read a book recently by Richard Dyer. It's called White, and he basically talks of how white is the norm. So, because the white people control their identity and how they're viewed, but they also control how everybody else is viewed. So they've kind of made this image that white people are like a blank canvas in the background, and everything else that happens, happens on this blank canvas. They're the ordinary, and everybody else is like not ordinary, not the norm, essentially. And that's an ideology that we need to kind of move away from and get rid of. So when people ask me what I think needs to happen and needs to change, I definitely say that we need to change a mindset, because it's a mindset that's been rooted in people from growing up. It's like generations and generations back. And they say, well, how are we going to do this? And maybe start an education system at home. But it's all these things that slowly, as horrible as it sounds, are dying out, we hope. Slowly with generations, things die out and they move on. And I think we'll have to stay positive and we'll have to stay hopeful for the future. And stay strong in what you believe in, stand up for what you believe in. And it's about the small things that you can do in your community at the moment, because that is what really does make a change. I mean, if everyone all organises huge protests, eventually it's not going to be as effective as it could be. But if everybody's doing small things in their communities, that are bringing their communities together and uniting people, making people feel positive about their skin colour, making people feel positive about who they are, their identity, and educating themselves on their identity and where they come from, who they actually are, then that will be so much more effective and so much more powerful. But okay, yeah, thank you so much.
Our next speaker might be our last speaker. If we can't get our speaker from America on Skype, so we're just dealing with the technology at the moment. So our next speaker is Gary McFarlane, who is a journalist and a Black Lives Matter activist.
And I'm a Black Lives Matter activist, member of the National Union of Journalists, on the Equality Council and the Black Members Council. And to start off with, why Black Lives Matter? Why are we talking about this in Britain? Because apparently some people in the media are confused about that, because we don't live in the same horrific circumstances that black people in America do. Well, 1,500 people killed since the 60s, is it? 1,500 in police custody or after contact with a police officer in this country. We've just heard from Kadisha. We know I'm from Tottenham. We know all about the police in Tottenham. So yeah, they're killing us here. It's not just on the streets. It's not just in the police stations. It's also in the mental health institutions of this country. All of these stories are untold stories. The stuff that the media doesn't talk about. They don't talk about these things unless you go on the streets and start to fight. And that's why Black Lives Matter matters in Britain. And then they say that, if you compare Britain to the USA, that you know, things are very different in this country. Well, they're different, but it doesn't mean that racism doesn't exist in this country. Okay, it is the case that the United States of America has 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the prisoners. Not quite that bad in this country, but it is the case in the United States of America, but half of the people in those prisons in America are black, 1 million out of the 2 million people in prison. And that's just the tip of the iceberg in terms of the whole judicial system in that country. So basically a black male born today has got a 1 in 3 chance of being in prison if current trends continue. There's been a lot written about this, Black Lives Matter, From Black Lives Matter to Black Liberation by Taylor. Everyone should go and read that book. And it's basically, it shows how deep deeply embedded racism is in that country. And it's rooted in slavery, it's rooted in how American capitalism grew. So the idea that we can actually get rid of it just through protesting alone, I'm not, well, that's the key to it, but that alone in itself, we have to say, well, it's more than just a protest, or more than just a few people at City Airport. What we need is a mass movement on the scale of a civil rights movement. What we need is a second revolution, which is what some people saw the civil rights movement and the Black Power movement that came after it in the United States. And in Britain, is it any different in that sense? I don't think it is, because if you look at our so-called democracy, it operates in the interest of the 1%. If you look at the police, they operate in the interest of the rich, the people at the top of society. Hands up, the last time you saw a banker go to prison. But I know lots of kids that went to prison in Tottenham for taking stuff out of shops. I know women that took nappies that went to prison, people that took water, bottles of water that went to prison in this country. So we have the same racist setup, the same racist system, and the same system that operates in the interests of the elite, which is why we say actually Black Lives Matter in Britain. There's been a lot of talk about white people in the movement. People in the media say, but you know, you see all white people as the enemy and so on. I think it's first to say there's lots of different groups in the Black Lives Matter movement. I use that as a small M, because there's lots of people in the movement and all over the United States, and also sprung up all over this country. There are demonstrations not just in London, in Manchester, in Liverpool, in Birmingham, in Leeds, all over the country. Literally something like 50,000 people involved in protesting on the streets over this issue. And if you look at those demonstrations, if you look at the Sheffield demonstration, for example, which I think is about a couple of thousand people, anyone here from Sheffield, but it was predominantly white. You look at the demonstrations in London, they were predominantly black, but included a hell of a lot of white kids on those demonstrations. They were very young demonstrations. So I don't think it's an accident, actually, that the Black Lives Matter movement is happening now, not just because of solidarity with the United States of America, but because of solidarity with ourselves, because we know we've got a fight on our hands, and this is a historic fight. I know, people come out of those kind of words like historic, but it is. You know, people are talking about going back to the 1930s. You can see where this government is going in this country, where they're whipping up the hate. They're trying to, you know, the hard Brexit that was already mentioned at the beginning, that is about blaming refugees and blaming black people. And there are some black people in this country think that, yeah, it's the Muslims here, yeah, it's the refugees, but we're okay. We've been here a long time, don't mess with us. But actually, they are going to be messing with us. Because it's the same racism, it comes in different forms. People think racism, like Caprice is saying, in terms of identity politics, people get very confused about this. You know, racism exists, not because race exists, because they invented racism. They invented it to justify slavery, to justify colonialism. But actually, race as a concept, as a scientific concept, doesn't exist. It's invented. It's a mechanism for divide and rule. The BBC was mentioned, excellent programme this week on Equiano, you know, a great black Britain. And the fact that, and they're talking about the free and the black community in Liverpool, and the fact that actually lots of white people in Liverpool are related to those black people, and they're white. Races don't actually exist. It's a scientific concept. There's more difference, genetic difference, within so-called races than there are between so-called races. So what I'm trying to get to, just to finish, is actually with the movement going forward, we have to not repeat mistakes of history, but learn the lessons of history. So let's talk about Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. When they died, when Malcolm died in 65, he'd gone from a position where actually white people were all a problem, they were all a devil, every single one of them, to a position where in 65 where he said, actually I regret turning away the white student at campus who came up to me and said, what can I do to help? Because now I understand that they can help. We talked about how the future revolution is not necessarily going to be a white and black revolution, it's going to be a revolution of all of those who are against oppression, against the oppressors. We began to see that actually black people in America, as 12% of the population, we need allies, and the same in this country. And you know, how are we going to get there? And Martin Luther King went on the same trajectory, from believing just by getting integration into capitalist America, we'd get the fruits of all of that. All that happened was we got an increase from 1% to 10% of the black people earning over $100,000 in the USA, and we had an increase from 400 elected officials in 64 to, what, 10,000 elected officials in America, black elected officials now. That's a great advance, but what's happened? Actually, it's acted as a safety valve. So when we saw the Watts uprising in 64, when we saw the Harlem uprising, when we saw every single major urban conurbation in America go up in flames in 68, there was no intermediary layer between the black community and the power structure. Today there is, unfortunately. Every single one of these places I mentioned, you tend to have black mayors, you tend to have black police chiefs, you tend to have black prosecutors. We have a big problem with some people in America, black people and white people are dealing with, which is the question of leadership. And Sanders was starting to point the way to a new kind of politics, a new kind of politics that talked about class, but also talked about race and how the two are intertwined. And actually, you can't talk about sorting out the class problem, the inequality problem, without sorting out the racism problem. But we need to look about where we've got power. And to finish, 1 minute, where we've got power, my family from New York came over in the summer, about 20 of them. And most of them work. One works at a place called Verizon. This is a phone company in America. And it's unionized, and they went on strike. They went on strike for a few weeks, and they actually won their contract. They actually won their strike. And this is a really powerful group of workers. And that's a black man. There's other black workers there. Well, what I'm trying to say is actually there's an idea that the black community, none of us work, none of us do much and stuff, and we're all on the street, blah, blah, blah. The majority of people in America, black people, work. Same in this country. And that's where we do have power, but we have to use it politically. So I think we need a mass movement, excuse me, my mouth is sealing up a bit. mass movement allied to where we've got economic power, and use that economic power for political ends. And that's where the Black Power movement finished off. If you look at the high points of it, with the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, to give them their full name. They were a socialist organization that understood, yes, actually we're a black-led organization, but we're gonna look for black allies. And they went off, they went and found black allies, but the key ally they needed was in the workplaces. That's where we have power. They wiped out the Black Panther Party, they destroyed them, decapitated them, the FBI killed them, forced them into exile and so on, because they were such a flex of the system, all 5,000 of them, that's all it was, at the height of the Black Panther Party. But their ideas was the real threat to the system. They talked to black about class unity to destroy racism and to destroy capitalism that created racism. That's the way forward as I see it. And actually it's in the workplaces where we do have power. And as I say, in America they start to organize in the car plants, the Dodge Revolutionary Union movement organized tens of thousands of workers in the car plants. And they can cause strikes in the lines and cost these people tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. That's the power we need to mobilize to get Black Lives Matter. But you know, we go through these battles every generation. We need to talk about black liberation, and for that we need to talk about getting rid of the whole system that creates it in the first place and keeps it breeding and changing every generation in order for us to fight each other instead of fighting the real enemy, which is the people that created and invented racism. I'm talking about Mr. Cameron and his family. I've got nothing about Cameron against Cameron, no Cameron, but I know his family owned slaves. I know that the French society today, economy, owes its life to Haiti, because they forced Haiti to pay back in gold the compensation to the slave owners. And they were paying that money back until 1970. That's why there's 1,000 dead in Haiti today. So the legacy continues, and we're going to get justice, but we're going to get it by fighting on the streets and fighting in the workplaces and uniting our struggles, black and white, gay and straight, lesbian and gay and straight, I've got to cover that, disabled and able bodies, all people together who aren't part of the 1% should be on the sides of Black Lives Matter. That's what our movement is trying to build. It's an inclusive movement, albeit black-led, and it's a movement that includes all sorts of people, all sorts of strategies. I'm for Black Lives Matter movement, it's distinct from BLM UK, whatever. We're not interested in 6-10 and fighting about that. We're interested in the struggle on the streets. The movement goes up and down. There'll be more blasts and eruptions to come, and let's be ready for it. And in the meantime, let's fight this government, because it's a government of racists that is trying to actually divide us in order to trample over the rights of everybody, black and white. Thank you very much.
We are having a little technical issues with our sister in America, but when she's connected, I will ask her to come in. So I'm going to open the meeting up now to the floor. We have till 12 o'clock, so I'm going to ask people to keep their questions or contributions quite tight, and I might have to actually cut you off after a minute, so I'm sorry, it's quite a lot of us in the room. So, I'll take any questions.
Sorry, Mark, a short contribution there. John Carr from Liverpool. I took part in the Black Lives Matter demonstration in Liverpool in July, which was in response to what I call the assassinations of black people in America. Wonderful demonstration, spontaneously organised on social media by a couple of young black kids. 300 people on that demo. The police said they didn't want to go ahead with the demo. They refused and they went ahead with the demo, and then we lost the police within 15 minutes of that demonstration. We lost the police because we went on routes, which we don't normally do in the trade union movements and all the rest of it. Absolutely fantastic. It made a much better atmosphere incidentally that the police weren't on the demo, because as we know, most of them, we police ourselves anyway. Absolutely wonderful. At the end of that demonstration, a police inspector came up to one of the leaders of that demonstration, who incidentally was a special constable, a young black lad from Liverpool Lane, special constable. Police inspector came up to him and said, "I'm taking your warrant card off you because as a policeman you've been involved in a political demonstration and you're not allowed to do that." Effectively, he lost his job. That's the reality of it. Took us. The week after that, a young black lad, Mezzi Mahabad, was killed in the care of our local police. Not one of them coppers has had their warrant cards removed. That's the reality of black lives in Liverpool 8 from the black community as we speak now. On that demo in support of Mezzi Mahabad, there were 3,000 people on that demo, one of the biggest demonstrations I've seen in terms of unity in a long time in Liverpool. Just one final point. Comrades have already been talking about the media. We know a little bit about the media in Merseyside and how these streets and Hillsborough supporters. We fought them, we took them on, and we won. We went up against the establishment, the media, the politicians, the whole establishment, including, I have to say, shamefully, Labour governments as well, who refused to give them people an inquiry. So it was a long battle. The battle still continues, incidentally, on Merseyside against the Sun. He's started to try and get under the radar again. And what they're doing is selling in shops under the guise of another paper. We're on to it. We've already stopped 240 shops selling the Sun in the last year. Hillsborough and the demonisation of them people, it's the demonisation of people within the black community as well. The same paper is demonising black people, it's demonising Muslims and all the rest of it. We can fight and you can win, and that's the lessons of solidarity that we bring from Liverpool.
Hi, my name's Paula Peters and I'm from the National Steering Group of Disabled People Against CAPS, or DPAC. Kadisha, for you, Billy, you know, as a disability campaigner, you know, I live in Bromley. We see Section 136 used on a daily basis, especially against the BME community, who are just going about their daily lives and are picked off the streets and then taken into our local psychiatric unit, Green Parks, in handcuffs most of the time. And I was in hospital yesterday, actually, and what I saw was 10 police officers taking, probably it was about 25 in handcuffs, and they slammed him into the floor before a nurse even got to see him. So what I say to you, from all of us at DPAC, that we're with you in solidarity, and that any support we can give any of you, you have it.
Any questions?
No, I don't think anything. Okay. I'm Reverend Joshua from Birmingham. We would like to show solidarity with you. And we have a big crowd of church with you. Yeah, we will invite you to our church and make sure that things, you know, these things are in the public. I just like to say that in terms of media, a lot of things to challenge the rationalization of the reductionism, you know, because they pick up one case and publicize it and make sure everybody's mind receives as if this is the black people are like this. And I think we have to challenge both literacy for the white people, you know, learning that this is brought without proper authentic source, without proper references. So we need to challenge the media individually. I think these are the things, if we do it philosophically as well as practically, I think we'll be able to educate the public beyond the black lives. And I show solidarity with the Black Lives Matter. We'll be very happy to support in every way possible as a church. Thank you.
Before we take the next speaker, I think we've sorted out our technological problems. And we'd like to bring in Sonia Benetton from Wilmington, Charlotte. Hopefully. Sonia is a Black Lives Matter activist.
No?
Sorry about this. I'll take the next speaker. Yeah?
I don't know about you, but the sense of excitement I had when Obama was elected first time round has now been thoroughly washed away from my kind of consciousness. You know, to see the premier slave-owning nation elect to the highest office a black man was such an achievement. And so many of us thought, now we're going to see some change. And of course, in the intervening years, what have we seen? Standard of living for the majority of black people is going down, not up. Invading other people's countries and putting them under the imperial yoke has continued. Guantanamo Bay is still open. And all of the torture, and I describe what happens in the penal system in America as torture, continues completely unabated. And now we have the sight of almost weekly killings of black people, unarmed black people, on the streets. And what can Obama do? He can say, well, that could be my little girl. But beyond that, Obama can do nothing. What does this point to? It points to something that Gary was saying, I think. Just that it's very tempting to think that if we get the right individuals in positions of power, that we can change things. That if only we had, in Britain, a black prime minister, if only we had more black MPs, if only we had more black judges. And I heard, you know, David Lammy, the MP for Tottenham, saying the other day, the way to solve the question of police racism in Britain is that we need more black police. But I'm sorry, look at the number of black people in America who've died at the hands of black police. The problem is not the individuals, the problem is the system. And the system, you imagine, we have a system that can only function with a tiny minority of people at the top if the rest of us are divided. If we see each other as competitors and enemies because of what pigmentation, cultures, religions, or whatever they use to divide us. And so I think the solution is not to put more black people in positions of power. That's a diversion. The real struggle is to get all the people who've got a vested interest in them overthrowing the system to act together.
So I'd like to welcome Sonia. I don't know if she can hear me or see me. Welcome, Sonia.
My name is Sonia. I'm from Wilmington, North Carolina. And I'm very honored that you have me there today. I'm speaking on Black Lives Matters, because when Black Lives Matters, then all lives will matter. In Wilmington, North Carolina, we've had many fatalities. Unarmed people killed by law enforcement. We had one case in 2013 where an unarmed black man was shot 27 times by law enforcement. And so far in the United States, unfortunately, whether it's nationally, no matter how much publicity it gets, none of the law enforcement have been held accountable for shooting unarmed men, women, and children. And it's a big problem here in the United States. No matter whether they have audio or not, none of the officers are held accountable. And these are signs that the system has to change. And in the United States, our candidates make those decisions. None of the candidates, in my opinion, have imposed enough to change the system, because this has been going on for over a century. This is not a new problem in the United States. in Charlotte, North Carolina. I'm sure you heard about the unrest in Charlotte, North Carolina, last brutality, and I appreciate the courage of those, because it's not about the looting, it's about the justice. Where there's no justice, there will never be any peace in the United States. And it's the same living in a country that our foreparents helped build, and we're still fighting the same battles and the same crisis as the late Dr. Martin Luther King, Marcus Garvey, and others. Nothing has really changed here in the United States. They just have a new way of doing it. And we will stand strong. We will not take this silently. We will unify together as one. And that, and at times it gets hard, and you wonder why they call it Dr. Martin Luther King's dream. And that's what it is, a dream, because it's very far from reality in the United States.
Yeah.
Well, we know that, and unfortunately, I'm sure you've heard of, we have candidates that we are going to be holding accountable on local, state level, because the candidates actually make these laws, they change the laws, there's no law, they cannot be rewritten. And a lot of times they want us to forget. We will not forget.
Yeah.
We will not stop. We will not be quiet until we get justice. Because where there's no justice, there's no peace. And we stand with the family of the victims. We do give the victims respect as well, and we appreciate the courage of the family of the victims for standing strong in this battle for justice here, not only in Wilmington, but across the country.
Thank you, Sonia. Does anybody have any questions for Sonia?
And I would like to add one more thing about the history in Wilmington. In Wilmington, North Carolina, we had the only government takeover in 1898, where blacks were killed in a government takeover in 1898. We had a massacre in 1898, right here in this very town. There's still no reparations. In this country, everyone has got reparations except for the blacks in this country. The Indians, the Eskimos, the Japanese, everybody but the blacks who helped build this country on the blood and sweat and tears of our ancestors.
Question for Sonia.
Hi, brilliant to have you join us. You know, how are things going to change? How can they change from having, you know, the demonstrations, the big demonstrations that we've seen people on the street at night that then get curfewed? How can things come together from that movement to create something that will challenge the status quo and create that bigger change? Obviously, you've got the elections. It seems like no choice, Trump or Clinton, you know, what choice is that? What change is going to come from that? No change came from Obama, did it? So nothing's going to come from that. So how are you going to break through, and how can we help you?
Thank you very much, and that's very true. Nothing's changed with the candidates, but we do have candidates on the state and local level that we can hold accountable and hold their feet to the fire until they change the system. They make laws, they create laws. But also it's caused us to unify here in the United States more than ever, and it takes more than protest. We can protest all day, but until they make laws to change the system, to make these officers accountable, it's really not going to be effective. And other blacks in this country are getting tired of marching, and they're taking, they're considering other methods for change.
Any other questions? Sonia, if you're happy to stay at the end so you can listen, we carry on meeting with questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, thank you.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you.
We'll carry on. If anyone has any more questions or contributions?
Rising in this country, because we need you, you know,
We really need you to change things, and there are many, many actions that you can get involved in now. Please do. Please stand up. Fight.
Anyone else? Just shout if you need the mic.
I'm a history teacher. In the UK, definitely when it comes to the race, the narrative does seem to be very American-centric. And also with Black Lives Matter, the media is, you know, very American-centric, very positive, and that's great. But as we've talked about with the UK, it's all under the surface. And kind of in my role as a teacher, I wanted to ask, like, how can I direct my students to sort of more reliable media outlets who are going to tell them about, you know, what's actually happening, how Black Lives Matter work in the UK, kind of what the situation is in a more positive way, because the Black Lives, some of the stuff that I've seen in the media for Black Lives Matter in the UK has been quite negative with the Heathrow and, you know, that kind of stuff. So how can I direct them to sort of the more reliable media information?
Hello? Alright. So far, as our movement continues to expand, we will have our own media outlet where we can cover certain situations. We will talk about a variety of situations, not only to do with police brutality. We'll talk about racism when it comes to employment, racism in the courts, racism in the schools, and so on and so forth. So there will be several media outlets where we can discuss these issues. Because I do agree with you. I feel as if you look at sort of the conservatives and conservative media outlets, they try to brush aside this issue by saying, I am blind to the issue of race. Well, what this leaves is to say, we don't really care about what's going on if you're discriminated against, because we're blind to it. We can't really see it happening. So in a sense, we want to give exposure and give light. And a lot of this has already been covered. A lot of sociologists have already done studies to show that there is a lot of discrimination in the UK and in America.
Thank you. I think two quick things. The first one is about the mental health issue, dealing with violence. Day in, day out, black single mothers whose children are taking the whim of anything. And the first thing they turn on and tell them is, you've got a mental problem. Go and get the report. I'm dealing with a case now where a GP has actually written a letter to say, you're fine, you don't have any mental problem. But the social services, well, not doctors, they're insisting that you've got a mental problem. Just looking for ways to take this poor lady's children and mess them up, because when they go to care, they always come out the other way around. The other thing I want to say is that Black Lives Matter, yes, here in America, but it's crazy what's going on in Africa. As I speak to you now, people are dying in their numbers. But the United Nations peacekeeping force have been in that country for ages. It's kind of extraordinary that where these peacekeepers are, coincidentally, they tend to be wealthy, mineral-rich countries. But the citizens of these countries are dying every day, poverty, while aircraft are leaving with these golds and diamonds and everywhere, all of them, and heading to one direction. It is not only about the United Kingdom, it's not only about America, but France too. All the French colonies still have their reserves in French treasuries, earning no interest. And when they have asked for this money back, they give them with interest, and ask them to pay interest on the money they give them. So it is big, it is really big, and unless we all come together, and we honestly want to fight this problem, it is going to continue, because when we concentrate one corner, the other corner is getting rotten. Yes. Just look at what is going on in the DRC today. In fact, it's bizarre that children of 10, 11 are being killed because they come out of the street with their parents to ask the president to respect the constitution. And who is saying anything about it?
No one.
We don't see it anywhere, but people are dying. So it is bad. It is really bad.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'm from apartheid South Africa, and Africa experienced what people now call austerity here in the 1970s with IMF, imposed structural readjustment program, privatization of water, privatization of just about everything, cuts in health and education. The other thing that for me was exciting about Black Lives Matter in England was the issue of pollution. Because in America, we know that the water contamination that was happening there was ignored by both Trump and Clinton because it was black people who were getting sick and ill. We know that in the fracking in Canada, it was affecting the native Canadians who lived where the river was going down. They were getting cancers and illnesses, and it was ignored. We know that in India, Coca-Cola have taken over the water supply, farmers have died, people have died, and lots of other global companies causing pollution, dumping in Africa, in India. So we've got really an international issue here of fighting not just capitalism, but linking the issues. Climate change has the biggest effect on black and minority ethnic people around the world. So in Africa, we're having desertification, which also was one of the reasons we had people leaving Syria, and also land grab. There's huge land grab and speculation going on in Africa, people being turned off the land, who are self-sufficient farmers, and they're losing their livelihoods and food because of speculation of global elites. And it doesn't matter if they're black or white skinned, white women or men, they are global elites, and they have nothing to do with the rest of us. And we really need to find a movement that unites the world and look at our struggles and stand us between all of these issues.
I just would like to. I just would like to ask you. Well, one point about education, because the educational system is just actually increases and establishes the way we see each other, just for black people, minorities, etc. But also, my question to you is: I always felt that the idea of minorities, ethnic minorities, or black minorities, is already a discrimination, because it makes that these people, whoever, as myself as well, foreign. So it's almost that terminology already separates us and makes that we are separated, and somehow it's a minority, so it should be put aside because it doesn't represent the majority. So maybe we should study the language, how we speak about these issues, because the way we speak as well is possibly oppressing the way to liberation. And also please comment about the educational system in Britain, because the wealth in this country comes from the slavery trade, capitalism, etc., and the United States, the wealth of the United States. So basically, for education, we need where we all come from and the wealth, and that maybe it clarifies as well. And please tell me if you agree about this ideology of minorities. Thank you.
Hello, brothers and sisters. My name's Dean Ryan. I'm part of the Black Lives Matter movement. And really, what I want to talk about today is the real importance of the job we have in our hands at the moment, the importance of making sure that people are really visible, really loud, really vibrant anti-racist movement. I mean, we look at what's happening at the moment post-Brexit, we see that every horrible, scummy little racist has now been given confidence to go out, to call people names, to attack people, to do stuff. And actually, we see from the Tory party conference, people like Amber Rudd making openly racist speeches. Actually, this is not an accident. If you look back to the Tory party conference when Theresa May was only the Home Secretary, she got up and made a speech saying that immigrants and migrants are a drain on resources, they do no economic value, that they are a pressure on public services. Actually, I work in the public services. I work for Islington Council down the road. I work with vulnerable young people. And actually, what I've seen is since 2011, when I work with vulnerable young people, our team had a team of 56 really strong, mainly black workers. Now, our team are down to 8. That is not because of Romanians, that is not because of Polish people, that is because of Tory cuts. It's absolutely disgusting. And I'll tell you what, people are talking about the racist atmosphere here. I'll tell you, You might not be able to tell from my youthful looks, but I actually, yeah, I grew up in the late 70s and 1980s, and actually in London, not far from here, in a place called Hoxton, it was a really racist place, and the National Front were the third biggest party in London, and actually the atmosphere was really vile. I remember walking down the street with my little sister, walking through Hoxton Market, people spitting at us, calling us the N-word. I remember, you know, people saying, go back to your own country and all of this stuff. Actually, I was born in Hackney, raised in Hackney, went to school in Hackney, but actually this is my country, you know what? Right, so it's disgusting. And I remember there was a piece of graffiti in the wall, you know, walls out, Peckins go, I'm sorry for my language, but this piece of graffiti stayed on that wall for about 2 years, you know. And then all of a sudden there was a change. What was the change? Anti-racists got on the streets, started giving out leaflets, started having demonstrations, started organising and opposing the races. And I went from being a scared little boy of 12 to actually thinking, yeah, things are different around here. And I always remember when I grew up, I thought, how come things have changed so much around here? And it's only really when I started reading and started understanding the struggles and the organisations that people have. And I think the biggest commitment I have as an anti-racist campaigner is I was telling that young person what it was like growing up in Hoxton in the 70s. And he said to me, oh, Dean, my uncle knew to tell me stories like that. I can't believe things like that really happened. And I think that's a big compliment to us in this room to say that actually we're not going to go back to those days. Tamisa Ray and Mabud want to take us back to those things, but we're not going to let them go back. And I think really what the comrade was saying there about talking about language is important, but I tell you what's more important. Every single thing that comes up, I'm involved in the housing campaign, and actually what happens is when you talk about housing, that, you know, it's not the people, the international super rich, who buy properties and leave them empty. They're not the people who are getting blamed. It's migrants. So every time we organise, when we organise against cuts, we need to put an anti-racist argument. When we talk about housing, we need to put an anti-racist argument. And whenever the racists try and show their face in our towns, in our cities, in our colleges, in our workplaces, we need to organise. So every one of you have got a role to play today. And I'll tell you what, we're going to turn back the tide of racism and we're going to keep kicking those nasty, horrible Tories where it hurts.
Anyone else? Anyone else? Can we short?
I can try to speak loudly. It's actually a question for Sonia if there's enough time.
Okay, so you are going to need the mic then.
Okay.
Pass the mic, please.
I hope
you can hear me. This is actually a question that I was trying to formulate. So I was raised in North Carolina, so it was awesome to realize that someone from North Carolina was coming in to speak. And I'm aware of the 1898 history and how poignant that was, just in terms of movement, in terms of that sort of being the marker of having broken a fusion government between white and black people along the lines of economic interest that had been building at that time, and then the forces that then broke that, divisions along race and fear-mongering, the type of thing that we're facing yet again, and always have these kind of waves of using race to divide us when there's an opportunity to be united and to change a system. And instead we see black people and others murdered and exiled and blamed. And so my question to you is, I mean, there's so much news on who's being blamed on working class white people supporting Trump, and people who could potentially unite along common interests, but instead who are being divided along arbitrary lines of race, as we heard today, race being created real only because it's been created and it's real in the lives of people. So I guess I would love to hear anything that you could say about coalitions that are being built where people are united, because I feel like we don't hear enough of that. There's a lot of language of division among our politicians, and I would love to hear more of the counter-narrative of how people in North Carolina particularly are uniting to change an oppressive system.
I know that's a big question, but any information about unity would be helpful. So did that make sense, my question?
I think the question, the mic was
cutting in and out.
Skipping a little bit there. Exactly, what was the question again? I'm sorry. Are there coalition groups?
Yeah,
do you want to come closer? Just come into the aisle. Just come closer.
So anything that you could say about coalitions across lines of interest, uniting people across different religions, races. I feel like, especially in North Carolina, that the narrative is that everyone's divided. And I would love to hear who's involved and who's uniting to change the system and refusing to be divided along lines of races, as there's a significant history in North Carolina with people being. Does that make more sense?
Yeah, thank you for your question. You want to know how the coalitions with races, different races, is that what the question is?
Across lines of race, religion, sexuality, in order to change oppressive class systems that how, I guess that's...
Okay, thank you for the question. First, I'd like to mention I am the great-granddaughter of former slaves, and I'm empowered by that. Because if they can make it through the worst form of inhumanity, I have no excuse for failure. In Wilmington, North Carolina, I guess I'm very passionate about the 1898 mask. I'm very sensitive about that because the church I belong to that's still active, pastor at the time in 1898, was a Reverend J. Allen Kirk. And you can Google his statement up, and he talks about the horrific situation of the 1898 massacre. And a lot of times in Wilmington, I noticed they kind of pushed his statement to the side, and I never understood that. The church was built by former slaves, and it's a historic, beautiful church, and it's still active today, Central Missionary Baptist Church, where I am a member and a historian. My great-grandmother helped build that church. We do have the National Reparations for the Coalition. You can Google it up for reparations for the 1898 massacre. We do organize. I'm a member of the National Black Leadership Caucus. I chair the New Hanover chapter here in Wilmington. So we do have coalition groups, but unfortunately, we don't have enough white people in New Hanover County that want to make change. A lot of them are very happy the way they things are, unfortunately. We don't have, but we hope that will change. In the Democratic Party, for example, everything was lovely, but until I spoke out about Brandon Smith getting shot 27 times and the Democratic sheriff elected not holding this, holding his men accountable, they literally didn't want to hear that. So they care about a lot of the liberals here, unfortunately, want us to just vote for candidates. But they don't want to deal with black issues. They want black votes, but not black issues. So that day is ending. Very quickly. And there are some, it's only one race, the human race, but some people will have no regards for the human race here in New Hanover County. I have talked to ACOPs, and those of them who are ACOPs, they're one of the known as white supremacists in 1898. Charles Acock was the governor, and I talked to his great-grandnephew for his reparations, and it was almost like petting a snake and getting bit. So he actually did not say, well, I don't have an opinion on it. And that's confusing to me. You see people killed and everything else, and you just try to water it down and say, my uncle was a good person. And that's hard to believe when he passed laws of voter suppression that were passed down to generations to my family that was spit on in jail for trying to break through the vote. And right after the 1898 massacre, there was lynchings. So if you're not part of the problem, the solution, you're part of the problem. So in the Democratic Party did pass a resolution. I did get them to pass a resolution for reparations for reparations. But they were, however, when it got to the House, no one did anything with it. And the descendant of the Acock family didn't see the significance in that. So we're dealing with some deep-rooted things here in Wilmington, North Carolina. Matter of fact, Dr. King was supposed to be in Wilmington today. he went to Memphis and was assassinated. He just thought it was a better need there. Would anything change if he came to Wilmington? I doubt it very seriously, because this town really needs some healing on their perspective of relationships and equality here in New Hanover County.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm very mindful of the time, so I'm going to have to ask the speakers to come back. And can I thank everybody for their contributions and their questions? So can I ask Kadisha to come back first?
Okay, just want to say thank you for everyone for actually coming again today. The contributions is tremendous. The struggle continues. It goes to show change ain't going to come overnight. We have to build that collectively as a unity, as a solidarity. As mentioned before, even in America, if the movement had started in America for Black Lives Matter, where would we be here today? Literally, so it has to go forward in order to bring about change within this country. Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you also for coming. I just wanted to make a final word that there are infinite physical, biological, and genetic differences amongst human beings. And this unfortunately means some have a huge social significance and others literally don't. So race, what I'm saying is race is a social construction that gives particular characteristics a huge social importance. So we have the power to make this change. Meanings shift over time. That's what social construction is. We change over time. So just remember that we can change this and yeah, we can change this.
coming from Liverpool, mentioned MZ Mohammed, who was killed by the police up there in this huge demonstration that took place. And I think that the anger that people felt in Liverpool was replicated all over the country. So I think the question isn't so much will people come out and demonstrate, will people come out and protest, but I think the big question people have been asking inside the movement and been asking here today to some extent is actually where do we go from here? Because we've had the huge protests in the United States of America, the Civil Rights Movement, we've had the Black Power Movement, we've had the Black Panthers we talked about and so on, and now we've come full circle, and it looks like we haven't really got any further ahead, and in some ways things have gone backwards. It's very reasonable to argue that there's a new Jim Crow in America, Jim Crow being the system of legal segregation that used to exist in the Deep South, and it's now come back, and it's come back in the form of the justice or injustice system. And that means that, you know, if you're a felon in many states of America, I believe, you can't vote. So that's a million people, black people written off, and who are in prison, besides the ones who have already been in prison or come out on parole and the rest of it, and you begin to see what they're doing to black people in America. But really, electing more black officials, body cams and stuff, I'm not against any of those things, but they're not going to actually make a fundamental difference. That's my problem with it. Because I've seen this Democrat Party, and we know the roots of the Democrat Party are in the Dixiecrats, the racists that used to run the South. They used to run the Democrat Party. So I don't really have much time for them, for those people. And actually, if you look at getting the police to do anything, the key thing to get the police to do anything is to get onto the streets, is to make them fear you, is to make them think that the movement is so powerful that we have to respond to it. It's not how many more black faces we have in high places, unfortunately. That's the sad truth of the matter, it seems to me. So even on body cams in the United States, I think, yeah, they've passed lots of legislation saying we must have body cams, but they've also passed lots of legislation saying it's up to the police whether they want to actually release the body cams. Well, that's great. You know, that's just really great. And when you talk about the killings of black people, now people know, we all know this in America, don't we? Everyone can have guns. Well, not if you're black. So every time you talk about, when the media, they talk about black people getting killed, and an unarmed black person was killed, this is the language that is often used, or he wasn't armed, or she wasn't armed, and so on. But actually, black people have a right to carry a gun. They shouldn't be killing them because they've got a gun or not got a gun. And it only becomes an issue when it's a black person. And then the whole language of actually why it's justifiable to kill black people is because they look scary. That's actually what a lot of police officers in the United States and in this country say. We had to put a speckled over him. Didn't see the case in London with a youth who was talking to his white girlfriend and they thought he was stealing her phone. And so they jump him and they put up this thing called a spit hood, like something out of Guantanamo Bay. And there's about six of them doing it. They justify this on the basis that we're black people are somehow strangely different. The mental health system. people have looked at this, and actually in Jamaica there's a very, very low incidence of schizophrenia. Come to London, come to Birmingham, come to this country, and you find that actually mental health amongst black people is very, very high. Now why is that? Because of racism, that's why we're here today. It's simple, really. But I don't want to admit it, I don't want to actually say that. And I think it's a good point about minorities, ethnic minorities, yeah, because we're actually, I know it stands very liberal, one race is a human race, but actually it's a matter of scientific fact, that is the case. And we all came from Africa, I don't know, circa 50,000 years ago. You know, so everything that came after that is to do with the way human beings have not chosen to organise our societies, but who managed to come out on top. The people that had the biggest stick back a few hundred years ago became the kings and the queens, or the emperors and the empresses, and so on. So anyway, what I'm trying to get to is actually, where's this idea of minorities? Where does it take us? Actually, I'd like to talk about unity and us all being together. Well, it takes us to a situation where in the 60s and the 70s, when we're going forward, our identities were identities as revolutionaries, or as people who wanted to change the world, and so on, from Bob Dylan to Bobby Seale. We had an identity about the struggle, about the movement, but when the movement got blocked and was stopped and got turned around, and when Richard Nixon, the president there, said, yeah, I like black power, given to black capitalism, that's what it needs, and that's what it did, and actually it managed to suck these people into the Democrat Party and into power structure and so on. So actually identity politics is what replaced that. So instead of actually uniting with gay people, the Gay Liberation Front took their name from the National Liberation Front of the Vietnamese, and the Vietnamese learned from the Black Panther Party, and the black, and so on. Everyone learned from each other, all the different oppressed groups and so on, because we're going forward. But as soon as we start to go backwards, things got internalized, then we got into identity politics. Well, who's more oppressed than who politics? Which is a dead end compromise, it's the dead end people. And that's the kind of minority politics we don't need. But actually what we do need is unity. And I've noticed it from, you know, lots of people in London, anyone goes to prep, and they do coffee and stuff or whatever. But I've had, since the referendum, I keep counting, I think it's 11 or 12 free cups of coffee. They give you free, the workers are allowed to give free cups to people they like or whatever. I've had a massive peak. I've just looked at the graph, I've had a huge peak. Because they associate me, I talk to them about the job, and say, how shit is it working at prep, and yeah, I go on the deadline next week, whatever. So then now I'm a lefty, and so they identify with me on the basis that actually he must have voted down this Brexit thing. Actually, I'm against the European Union, because I think it's a neoliberal austerity engine, and based on racism and 10,000 people at the bottom of the Mediterranean who all happen to be black and brown. So it doesn't mean a lot for me, this Brexit thing, but the EU's anti-racist, but I know they've used it to stir up racism. My dad, Lincoln, was saying, sorry you voted that way, Gary, but anyway, I'm very, very aware that it's going to have a trickle-down effect, and I'm telling you, Lincolnshire is UKIP land. And it's the only place I know in this country who walked down my parents' road, they've got one guy who's got a Union Jack stuck in his garden, like he's in America with the Stars and Stripes, doing it in America. Don't kind of do that in this country. Well, these people do it up there in Lincolnshire, all these farmers and stuff. And, there's a sea of racism coming towards us, but let's not get to the feeling that actually all of a sudden the referendum has meant that there's actually more racist. I think what's happened is that there is a core of racism in this country. It is widening to some extent, but there's a core, and they've become more confident. Of course they've become more confident, because they've got the racists in power who are pushing their policies. So actually I think we should be confident by the fact that we're going to go and hear Diane Abbott speak in a moment. I don't know what you think about Lo-Fi, but the point is, she's actually someone that does stand for black liberation. She has fought historically to do something for black people, has fought historically to link the issue of racial equality to the issue of social equality, and she's now the shadow Home Secretary. That will help our movement. The fact that Corbyn is where he is will help our movement, which will give us confidence that actually the fact that 50,000 marks over Black Lives Matter, 100,000 or more for refugees when Corbyn got elected the first time round, shows us that actually people want to do something. I know it from even at the top of society, I've just finished, at the top of society in America, and we need to get this happening in this country, you've got the footballers going on making their statements at every football match. It spread. The women were leading the way women's basketball, they led the way. And it's been followed by the big stars, the Serenas, the Beyoncés, Beyoncé doing a copy of the Black Panthers, basically, at the biggest advertising event on TV in America, the Super Bowl. And that would be our Black Panther, you know. So you could talk about appropriation or whatever, but it just shows that actually even if you're a millionaire, you're still affected by racism. But we haven't seen that in this country. We've got to start building up the pressure. When Dalian Atkinson got killed, but someone that people know beyond politics and stuff, or the black community and stuff, where are the black footballers getting up and doing some stuff for the footballers? It's because but someone hasn't asked them. So we've got to start getting serious, people. Do what we did in the 1970s, make build a mass movement, get the gigs going, hundreds of thousands of people that we organise at carnivals, all of that, and stopping the EDLs or whatever it is or trying to organise on the streets, back to stopping the big races, so the ones that go around in suits and call themselves the Conservative Party of this country, they're the real enemy. Just to finish, people join up to racism, come to the United Friends and Families March on the 29th of this month. It happens every year. We want to make this one of the biggest there's been for a long, long time. And I think we can do it if judging by the reparations were mentioned. We had our biggest ever reparations march ever in this country, which came out of the Black Lives Matter towards the end of the most recent protest, something like 3,000 people in the protest in London. That is unheard of. That's because people are starting to think we've got to do something. And that's spread beyond the black community, and that's off to the white community also. That's black and white. People are understanding that we've got to start moving. So thanks for coming, people, and look out for future protests. Get involved. Take a thousand races.